Hey guys, it's time for a Facebook Live. It is Friday, however, at noon. Usually we do this on Wednesdays, but we're very excited to talk today with three folks who were involved in that unbelievable rescue that made national headlines all over the world, it seems like. Larry Coren, who was the chopper pilot of some renown that you are now, he's of some renown, that's for sure, from the Bernalillo County Undersheriff's Office. We really appreciate you being with us today, and we very much appreciate you bringing on is with us, Joseph Waller, he's with the Bernalillo County Fire Rescue Specialist with BCFD, the fire department, and Drew Harrell from UNM's Mountain Medicine Rescue Specialist. From the UNM Mountain Medicine Department. We'll get you the full title here in a quick second. Sorry about that. We'll hook up UNM. Let's start with you, Larry. Unbelievable situation. I watched MSNBC. I'm amazed at the places it got around there. But let's talk first about how this works, frankly, on Sandia Mountain. And what I mean by that is we've had a lot of folks move into this community in the last time, a period of time, where there really hasn't been a high-profile mountain rescue for a little bit of time. And sometimes it feels like folks don't understand how very dangerous sometimes the Sandias can be, not necessarily this tram situation, but just being out there. Could you talk about that a little bit, Larry, to get us going and how your operation works in regard to that?
Sure, Gene. So the Sandia Mountains, the top of the Sandia Mountains, right at about 10,300 feet. And it's one of the highest peaks in the middle of New Mexico that we end up working in. There's quite a bit of travel and tourism in the area. And people, especially during the Balloon Fiesta and some other events, like to go up the mountain, hike up the La Luz Trail. It's nothing to be taken lightly. We do our best to encourage people to go prepared, have a fully charged cell phone, take water, dress appropriately for the weather. This particular rescue, of course, was a little bit of a different situation. These were employees that were working up at the 10-3 restaurant, which is up on top of the peak. Our involvement in this rescue was basically to provide a crew of well-trained helicopter rescue personnel, and to see if maybe we could help with that extraction of those passengers.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let me get the other guys swung in here. For the fire department, I'm curious, for the county, what's the relationship with Larry's End of the World, and how does that work when it comes to rescuing someone on the hill? Who leads, who does what in this kind of a situation?
So Bernalillo County Fire Department and the Bernalillo County Sheriff's Office, we work together in a joint venture for this rescue team with the helicopter unit. Bernalillo County Fire Department supplies the paramedics and rescue specialists to be assigned out with Larry and the Bernalillo County Sheriff's officers at the hangar. And we're out there on a full-time basis, and we train pretty much daily. And when we're not out there, we're training, you know, two or three times a month for these types of instances. So on the fire department side, you know, whoever's assigned at the hangar at that time is in charge of county personnel. And then we work very closely with UNM reach and treat physicians and paramedics as well.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's a great segue. Thank you very much for doing that, to swing off to Drew Harrell and where your operation swings in. And Drew, because I screwed up your title, could you give us that one more time and your association with the university?
Sure, Gene. Thank you so much. And Joseph, thanks for the plug. So we have, Gene, we have a group of paramedics and emergency medicine physicians. I'm an emergency medicine physician. I work at the University of New Mexico at UNM Hospital and provide care there. But we also have a group of us within the Department of Emergency Medicine within the International Mountain Medicine Center that do specific technical rescue and austere medical support. And we've been working with the collaboration along with BCSO and BCFD for, Larry, keep me honest, it's been five or more years, it might have been longer than that, where in the goal and the effort to be able to provide care in an austere environment, this is not your normal, as we will talk about today, not your normal run-of-the-mill EMS call where we could have significant concerns with access, with terrain, with weather, or prolonged periods where we have to spend a lot of time in the field to just to get to the point to extract someone. And then also one of the areas that we work on very closely with the Mountain Medicine Center is the technical rescue side. So a lot of the high angle technical rope rescue stuff. So we bring some of that and the group that we have between SO and fire and the Mountain Medicine Reach and Treat team have done really amazing things in terms of training and preparing for things just like this and building systems in place to be able to respond and mitigate risks and help people when we get the call, like we did on New Year's Day.
Mm-hmm. Is it similar to what Mr. Weller just mentioned, that you folks train a couple, three times a month as well?
We do. We do this through with all three entities. So any of the given entities will be out training on specific things with the aircraft, specific rescue techniques or medicine on a consistent basis. So we're familiar and we're ready to go when we get a call from Larry at whatever time of the day or night it might be.
I gotcha. Undersheriff Corin, that brings me right back to you. And let's get into the situation that was and with a good result there. First things first, I'm curious about the timeline. When did you first get made aware in your office that this situation was happening?
Yeah, so for this particular call, I happened to be out on a early morning walk with my wife down near the University of New Mexico, and which is about 3.5 miles away from my home. Mm-hmm. And I ended up getting a call from one of our rescue specialists who works for UNM. He's part of that technical mountain rescue group, Jason. And he gave me a call and gave me the heads up that something was coming up as far as a call for service, possible 20 people stranded on top of the tram, mid-span between some towers. And at that point, I placed a call to my son to come pick us up from our walk, but he was already on his way to work. He happens to work over at the tram himself. And he said, "Well, Dad, I'm almost to work. I'm not going to turn around now." And so I ended up having somebody else give us a ride over there. But at that point, that kind of initiated everything on our side, with the sheriff's side and our collaboration with the fire department and UNM, and just blasted out a text and made a few phone calls. And these gentlemen and our other crew members jumped into action and we set up a plan. And this is, Gene, this isn't something that is foreign to us, looking at tram rescues. It's something that we've worked with the tram and the tram management for some time, several years, in fact. And we've run different scenarios, sometimes just tabletop scenarios, sometimes actually getting up there on the tram and playing out a scenario of a stuck tram situation. So we just had to get all the resources in place to include having some specialists there at the parking lot of the lower tram, and then having other personnel respond to the hangar and get a fuel truck nearby and take care of some of those logistical matters that help us make it basically an effective and safe rescue. Mm-hmm.
Larry, at what point did you know that a helicopter was going to be necessary here and that you weren't going to be able to just rappel and walk these folks out? Was that an immediate decision, something a little bit later? When did that happen?
Well, you know, any search and rescue around here, we always consider using the helicopter as even a means of a first resort to any rescue, because there's that search component in trying to locate people, even if it's just locating them from the air and then directing ground personnel to them. So once again, this was something that we did have a plan of sorts put into place at some time for the potential of this happening. And so, and this is a response by a lot of search and rescue stakeholders in the community. And so we knew that resource would be valuable to have during this type of rescue.
Gotcha. Drew, may I ask you, and I'll ask Joseph as well, do I have this correct that there was an attempt by some agency, not an attempt, it was done, an agency to walk up in the early morning hours and bring some supplies and things to the two tram cars? Do I have that right? It's something about 3:30, 4:30 in the morning, somewhere around there?
You do have it right, Gene. The timeline's a little off. So the New Mexico search and rescue coordinator that was on scene, Spencer Moreland, had been working very diligently to get ground resources. Because as you, for those of you that might remember the early mornings of the New Year's Day for January, just a few days ago, very windy, very cloudy, very low ceiling. So they had actually been working to get resources to the individuals trapped in the tram since I believe the first cruise, and this is, I'm trying to recall, but I think they had actually put people on the trail maybe as early as 6 a.m. After they put people on place. So there were people trying to make access, taking additional resources, taking equipment, and taking food and supplies to the people that were in the tram. That had been ongoing to about, that had been ongoing for about an hour to maybe an hour and a half from when we got our first personnel with the air unit on scene there. So they had had people going pretty much just before first light. And it took them a few hours to make access to the tram tower. And obviously it takes a little bit of time to get those people to the scene. And I think they've been working on that for several hours before we got there.
That makes sense. That makes sense. Joseph, I'm imagining that timeline you're familiar with as well. I'm curious what was brought to the folks. I mean, one of the things you hear on the street a lot about the situation is the all-night stay they had to have. And did they have to stay there all night? Was there just no possibility of a rescue in the dark? Again, it's easy to look back, but the helicopter was not going to be able to be used, you know, before daylight. Why did they have to stay overnight?
So this was a unique situation of the unknowns. So we didn't know exactly where the tram car was. We got the call at around, you know, just around six, a little after six, which is about the time the ground crew started hiking in. And we're trying to gather information at this point. When the crews got up there, they hiked in some warmer clothes, some food and water, you know, enough to keep their morale up and kind of get a situation report back down to command to Spencer. When we arrived there, we started, you know, collaborating with incident command to let them know what our capabilities are, evaluate the weather on spot to see what it was doing up at that location and develop a plan to get them out.
Was it something you had to lay out or some agency had to lay eyes on first to be able to get that plan going, or you just know the mountain so well, you pretty much had it locked? Let me stick with Joseph on that one and I'll swing to Larry in a quick say.
Yeah, it's best to have someone from the rescue organizations, someone to get up there to have eyes on to fully assess the situation before we just start moving people and equipment into an area of the unknown. So they were the first ones on scene hiking up. And by the time we got there, you know, the weather was already rolled in and we were having to wait until we got openings at that second tower. I mean, it was covered in clouds. So just waiting for our opening to get a helicopter there to start getting more resources. So I think that was a good call to send people on foot up there to assess it from a professional standpoint to give us a better idea of what's going on.
That's very telling. I hadn't realized you had mentioned cloud cover before. I hadn't realized it had come down that low. That second tower, that's a big difference right there. I could totally see now where you guys are kind of coming from on that situation there. Larry, once the decision's made, and I've had a couple people say, you know what, these rescue guys got a little bit lucky, and not how you did it, but where the tram ended up, meaning it could have been in a much worse spot and been a much bigger challenge for you. Is that an agreeable statement? Is that something you've thought about as well?
Yeah, I think overall I would agree with that statement. There was a lot of challenges with this rescue, and there's basically a couple of ways in which we train. And one method is to fly the helicopter near the suspended tram car, and extract people using what's called the short haul method, which is basically just a rope on the bottom of the helicopter. Take one of these gentlemen and dangle them from the bottom of that rope and insert them on top of the tram car. they would be, make their way through the hatch and into that gondola or that car and start harnessing passengers. And then I'd come back in with that rope, and they would attach those passengers, and then they'd go out that way. That was one method. It's in which we perform a rescue. The other method is to try to lower the passengers down to the ground using some kind of rappel system, and then picking them up on the ground somewhere. And so those are all things that we were going through in our minds. We knew we had high winds. We knew the visibility, it was sometimes zero at where those tram cars were. And then we had icing, some of the same conditions that forced the tram car to stop were concerns of ours as well. The tram operators and the owners of the tram were able to inch that tram car over to the tower, and the owners themselves actually hiked up there during those night hours and made their way over to the base of that tower number 2, climbed up the tower, and got on top of the tram car with the 20 passengers, and went into the hatch and started setting up, essentially giving them some care packages and starting to set them up for basically rappel. We waited for a break in the weather. Our first trip out there was to take some supplies for that rappel operation. And we dropped off some supplies. We also dropped off some warm weather gear in the event that they had to actually hike those passengers out. We waited and let them get set up with all that warm weather gear and the rappel system. Another wave of weather moved in, and then we ended up later on taking these two gentlemen here, Waller and Harrell, and dropping them off along with another person from UNM, Trevor, who's not here today, but dropped them in to assist with basically escorting the passengers once they rappelled to the ground over to the helicopter. Mm-hmm. This we were able to pull that off and get those 20 people off. I'm estimating in less than an hour, about 45 minutes or so. And it was challenging. And these guys could testify to the fact that it was not terrain that you'd want to take the novice hiker on and hike them out off that mountain.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I could see that, Drew. I could see that decision for sure, especially after the fact that these folks have been up in that situation all night. Their heads are in a different place. I could totally see that. But I'm curious what was found for the state of the folks in the car, meaning obviously physically they had gotten through, they had gotten stuff to stay warm and stuff like that. But I have to imagine you have to get folks emotionally ready for this next step, this rappelling thing. You have to give some instructions. You have to get people calmed down. You get people ready to go. Was there some difficulty there, Mr. Harrell, with that? Or were folks ready to go and pretty cooperative and it was just smooth?
So Gene, I would have to say, so the ground crews that actually made the initial contact were the ones that were doing the great job on getting people secure and getting the morale up, like Waller talked about. And they did an outstanding job of setting up a lowering system and getting them ready. And I believe that was some of the Sandia Peak employees and the owners, as well as Albuquerque Mountain Rescue and some of our other agency partners. So they had done a great job. And it looks like from the smiles that we saw on the faces of the tram employees when we got to them on the ground, they had been jazzed up and were very excited to be out of the tram and hopefully on their way home. And I think, they had done a great job with the initial rescue contacts and getting people, understanding that here's what we're going to do next. And we've got a weather window that we got rid of. You're right, Gene, you were correct. We did get lucky in the sense that the weather cooperated with us for enough of a window to provide us an opportunity. And I think we put together a really good plan and worked really seamlessly with our other agency partners. And once we got them going out of the tram car, which was happening really, if I recall correctly, Larry and Joseph's right, just as we were landing to get out to kind of start making contact, they had already put or were about to put the first employee on the ground from the tram car in that lowering system. And then once we got that going, it was about probably a couple of hundred feet, almost probably 100 yards of ground that they had to traverse from the base of the tram over to where we were landing the helicopter. And so we would bring them over in groups of two or four, kind of give them a quick brief, let them know it was going to be loud and it was going to be something they probably weren't familiar with, but we had it, we were safe. We do this all the time. And all of them were very excited for their New Year's Day helicopter ride, for sure.
Right. I love it. That's a great story. I think it's actually interesting. Joseph, you know, when I think about it again, it's easy to sit back after the fact and think about these things. But boy, I have to say, employees and folks who knew each other, that's a bit of a different situation than, say, it was a bunch of tourists and perhaps, you know, some elderly folks were mixed in there. Some health issues might've been mixed in there. Did that make a difference in your planning that you had some, you know, they're relatively young, relatively healthy people as opposed to a different kind of a situation?
Yeah, I mean, I think what we would plan for and our biggest fears were eased, knowing that they were all adults that had no health issues, no injuries. And I'm sure for the workers, they all already knew each other, and you know, during this ordeal, they probably made stronger bonds with each other. But definitely, if there were children and elderly individuals, that would change a lot of things as far as basic equipment we may need, who's coming out first and what have you. So we would have to basically do a triage at that point to try to see who's, you know, in the worst shape that needs to come out with weather windows. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. This is fascinating. I got a million more questions, but you guys have like real stuff to do. So I'm going to wrap this up here in a quick second. I'm so curious again, I have to like how I started with this. A lot of folks don't realize again, how dangerous a mountain can be at 10.3, 10.5, 10.4 in elevation. And Drew, could you speak to that a little bit? What kind of education do we need to do a little bit more with folks around here about day hiking and hiking in general? Are you seeing folks are generally pretty up to speed on this or something slipping in our understanding? How do you see the world right now and how we relate to the mountain?
Well, how we see the world right now is obviously a loaded question, right, Gene? Relative to mountain rescue and recreation outside, I think that's a great point. So we see consistently across the year, every year, we don't have high profile tram rescues where weather or whatnot requires us to be able to be involved in successful help for folks. But we do see a lot of people that underestimate the mountains and go out ill-prepared. And I want a couple of things that are really important for your listeners and for anybody around New Mexico or the world that's happening to listen to us on Facebook Live, right? It's easy to go up, it's really hard to take into account the things that are going to go wrong, you know, just before it gets dark. And consistently what we see people do here is underestimate the distance and overestimate their abilities and find themselves in situations where their cell phone's not charged or they weren't as familiar with the terrain as they thought they were and the weather changed or it got dark and all of those things kind of compound. And then they try and turn around and realize that I'm off trail and I don't have enough water and I'm really tired or I'm really cold. And they find themselves needing to be rescued. And it's really important for people to be prepared, as Larry talked about, like hike smart, make sure you have enough water, make sure you know where you're going, make sure you're prepared for what the weather is right now, but also for what you're going to find or maybe find yourself in 2 or 4 hours. And have the necessary resources and kind of training and understanding to keep yourself from becoming a casualty and needing to be rescued, because that's the best rescue is the one we don't have to go on. And I really want to reinforce for folks is that it's really easy to walk off from what looks to be a really simple little hike. And in the middle of the summer in July, you know, find out that you don't have enough water and you're not prepared and you end up really overcome with heat and or other weather. And we see this all the time, or you overextend yourself and you twist your ankle and you can't get down and it gets dark,
right?
And it's lonely up there by yourself at night. And I think those are the big things, Gene. Make sure you're prepared. Make sure you know where you're going. Make sure people know where you're going and have a way to call for help if you really need it.
Mm-hmm. You know, you remind me of a situation I was personally involved with about 10 years ago on the mountain where the three of us, the heaviest set person in our group, twisted their ankle. Mm. Let me tell you something. It is not easy to walk someone downhill.
Yep.
With those kind of, degrees of downhill when someone's really leaning on you heavily. If you're not an official rescue person, it's not easy. And it's I learned a good lesson that day, and I never forgot it. It was like, man, we didn't have to go more than a 3/4 of a mile. And it was brutal. I mean, it was really, really hard. And literally, let me start to wrap up here, because I don't want to take up y'all's time. How much of this is ego? And what I mean by that is, I think I'm a lot of like a lot of guys. I like to watch bushcraft videos on YouTube. I like to watch, you know, guys making campsites out in the middle of nowhere and, you know, doing their thing for days. I think it's great. I'm a guy. Sometimes I wonder if we think we can just manage more than we're actually able to as men sometimes. And we get ourselves turned around in these situations out of pure ego. Does that make sense at some level?
Yeah, I think as far as rescues go, and are people getting lost or injured on the mountain, that we want people to enjoy the outdoors. We want them to support that travel and tourism of our unincorporated areas of Bernalillo County, and Sandia Mountain is one of those areas. And it's just to do it smart. And I don't know how much of it is really ego. We find some people who are very well skilled at mountaineering who happen to twist their ankle. So I'm just fortunate to be working with these guys and with the group of search and rescue stakeholders to really make these rescues happen. You got to remember, Gene, the search and rescue here in New Mexico is not a paid industry. In fact, the relationship we have here with Bernalillo County Fire Department and UNM is a peer relationship. But we aren't compensated. We aren't compensating one agency or organization or the other. These people want to do this, and they enjoy the outdoors themselves, and they want to help serve the community, and that's what they're here for. Just like a lot of these other search and rescue stakeholders, to include Albuquerque Mountain Rescue Consortium. Even your IC of many of these search and rescue incidents, they're not paid. And so I just want to encourage people to support search and rescue stakeholders throughout the community, including some of the Cibola Forest Search and Rescue, all of them. They all do a very good job, and they're there to help.
I appreciate you saying that, because that gives me a good way to wrap up here, that the Albuquerque Mountain Rescue Council, you mentioned earlier, has their annual call for volunteers going on right now. It's very interesting timing. I'm hoping to get some good success out of this, because January 13th and the 25th from 6:30 to 8 p.m. at the Manzano Mesa Community Center, and that's abqmountainrescue.org. Email is info@abqmountainrescue.org as well. I got to wonder if a lot of folks will step in and really want to, you know, kind of pitch in now that this situation has happened. But let me thank again Larry Corin from the Bernalillo County Undersheriff's Office, Drew Harrell, of course, from UNM, and Joseph Waller from the Bernalillo County Fire Department as well. Guys, thank you for the time well spent. It was quality. I think there was just a lot of questions out there about how this all went down in the public, and I can't say enough. Thank you, thank you, thank you for what you do. I had to say it again one more time. Thank you. I mean, I couldn't even imagine living in this city without you guys doing your thing with our mountain and keeping us all safe. So we really want to thank you all for your time on this as well. Friday night, tonight, that is tonight, 7 o'clock, Channel 5.1. We will see you there for our regular show, the inaugural show of 2022, as a matter of fact. So until then, everybody be safe. No irony intended. Thanks, guys. See you next time.
Thank you, Gene.
Thank you.